Welcome to Open Networking TV. This is the catch up. And today we've got on the show for you JR Rivers of Cumulus Networks.
In recent times, networking has been in the way of customers. From a cost performance standpoint, networking was nowhere near the evolution phase that compute or even storage were at. And it's that transparency, I think, that the open source community gives to customers. It's not so much that a customer wants to go build something themselves. It's the fact that they can see inside if they choose to. Andreessen Horowitz happens to have led our Series A funding. And when we were talking to the partners, we started explaining what our vision was and why this mattered to us. Why are we interested in this whole networking thing? And Mark Andreessen latched onto both Nolan and I's core kind of visceral perspectives very early in the presentation. He stood up and looked at the rest of the partners and said, "Look, guys, it's clear that the Cumulus team isn't focused on reducing the cost of what somebody bought yesterday. The Cumulus team is focused on giving people way more networking than they had yesterday so they can write applications that they couldn't write yesterday and do things that we don't even know about." If I look out and I see companies like Cisco and others stand up and try and be the leaders of Internet of Things, from my perspective, you know, kind of crock of poo, the Internet of Things by definition is a federation. I have a loosely coupled ecosystem. I have bits and pieces that can connect to each other. My classic example I give to people all the time, when you turn your cell phone on, you connect to, you know, 10, at least 10 services through the network, whether it's the data network from your smartphone provider or through your Wi-Fi. It's all happening. You don't know who's transporting any of this data anywhere, but you connect to those services and you get the behavior that you're expecting out of it. And it's that federation is what makes it work. And the definition of federation means that nobody owns it. You don't get to decide Internet of Things is X because I am company Y and I'm big and I have a $40 million or $40 billion annual revenue stream. It's going to happen without you. We chose Linux as the foundation for the networking operating system because it allows federation. We have customers that put together well-known configuration management tools or some homegrown things, monitoring mechanisms. They use a set of tools that make sense for them in their environment, and it's very federated. All these pieces can work together or in exclusion of each other, depending on what a customer might want. And we just provide that platform or that foundation that an operating system is supposed to provide. Enterprises are looking at it saying, "I need to have that same flexibility on my side." And yes, I can look at something like VCE and get a V-block and plug it in. But when I look at the metrics around that, it doesn't align with what I expect from my business metric. I used Zanga as an early example, and I'll continue to use them because they've been pretty public about how they do this. When they decide that an application is matured, they can run their own private data center much more cost effectively at a much higher pace than they can by using public cloud. They grow new games in the public cloud because the expansion, the capacity, the ability to expand is very high. But once the game becomes mature, they've been moving it back into private cloud. And you're seeing roughly the same thing starting to occur in the enterprises, where some cases they use public cloud, some cases they use private cloud. They want the flexibility to do both. And they want to be able to look at public cloud as an expansion, not as a cost reduction, but as an expansion. If you're going to have private cloud, it has to measure up to public cloud. You use public cloud for a set of characteristics, expansion, maybe reliability, you know, global reach. There's a whole series of reasons why public cloud might make sense to you, but you don't want it to be because it's the most cost-effective way to do compute. Part of it's the platforms, part of it's the maturity, the underlying silicon, and part of it's the fact that we're working with the Linux networking stack, which is a pretty rich networking stack. So you're able to make minor modifications and move the whole industry forward. I want an open ecosystem around my data center. I want cloud admins. I want to leverage all of these technologies to build an infrastructure that allows me to build great business applications. And when you look at when people started thinking about cloud computing, it was a time, realistically, when networks were low capacity, servers were low capacity, storage was slow and fragile. And what's happened is the technology has matured. The servers are blazing fast right now. Storage is quick and low latency. You know, networks are becoming higher and higher capacity. which allows you to, you know, all these fears that people had around what does it mean to be cloud? You know, why do I have to build some super brittle infrastructure? Those all disappear, and you kind of end up with that computer. For those of you that are Star Trek fans, remember the computer that was everywhere and you could ask it anything? Well, that's where we're headed, right? It's a super high capacity computer that's everywhere and can do anything for anybody. Super high capacity interconnect, easy to deploy at scale, easy to acquire. It's kind of affordable capacity that's easy to get out there.